Dr. Michael O'Hanlon is a senior fellow at the Foreign and Foreign Policy and Director of Research for the Foreign Policy Program at the Brookings Institution, where he specializes in U.S. defense strategy, the use of military force, homeland security, and American foreign policy. He is also a visiting lecturer at Princeton University, an adjunct professor at Johns Hopkins University, and a member of the International Institute for Strategic Studies. Dr. O'Hanlon is also a member of General David Petraeus's External Advisory Board at the Central Intelligence Agency. Dr. O'Hanlon's latest books are Bending History, Barack Obama's Foreign Policy, and The Wounded Giant, America's Armed Forces in an Age of Austerity. He's also written hundreds of op-ed pieces for the print media and is a frequent guest on radio and television news and opinion programs. Tonight we've asked him to speak a bit about the presidential candidates and their likely impact upon their policies on defense going forward. He will speak for around 45 minutes and then take questions. And without further ado, Michael.
Thank you kindly. It's nice to see everybody. Thanks for coming out on a beautiful fall evening. And appreciate the opportunity to discuss this important topic, to see good friends and others who I don't know as well. But I look forward to the exchange with all of you, because I think that's going to be the fun, especially because my topic is sort of where politics meets defense. And so 3 weeks before Election Day, I think we should all allow ourselves to have a little bit of fun with this subject, too, and not get too technical, especially because, of course, we're in a field now, a time of year and a campaign season where it's a little hard to be too serious about all the specific technical things you're seeing in campaigns and candidates' platforms anyway, because there's obviously a little bit of blurring of some of the messaging going on. So what I want to do is identify the specific things that the candidates have said that I really think they will hold themselves to or be held to or mean sincerely, as well as the things that are more conjectural, aspirational, political, rhetorical, and try to distinguish a little bit, and then do some guesstimating about what this might mean for their actual defense policies if elected. And I want to do it in three simple parts. Start with overall defense budgets. How much would each candidate spend if elected? And then, obviously, we'll touch on sequestration a little bit, but I won't dwell on that too much, but I hope you'll bring me back to that in the discussion period if you'd like. Then I want to talk about specific weapons, force postures, deployments, et cetera, where the two candidates have been specific enough that we can try to identify individual pieces and see what it might add up to in terms of an overall alternative force posture of one type or another. And then finally, I think we have to think a little bit about the use of force, about what might happen in Syria, what might happen in Iran, what might happen in Afghanistan, because it's not very realistic to talk about defense budgeting in the abstract and just assume that it's going to go on a certain trajectory with or without, let's say, notionally, a war against Iran. I think the latter might have a little bit to do with the former, and so were it to occur. And so I think it's logical to try to discuss the likelihood of possible conflicts or new deployments, or wars, particularly in terms of Syria and Iran. But we could also talk about other places, if you wish, Libya, Yemen, what have you. And obviously, Afghanistan is an ongoing concern. And then there's the unknowable and unmentionable and who knows what else. So three parts, the budget, the specifics within the budget, and then the question of the possible use of force. And let me begin with sort of a pithy debate line that we've now heard the candidates talk about in both their presidential debates. Specifically, President Obama's wanted to cite this number a lot, which is that Mitt Romney supposedly wants to spend $2 trillion more over 10 years than the president, and $2 trillion more than the generals and admirals are even asking for or want, which is the way the president's put it. An interesting set of comments. To the president's credit, he hasn't been rebutted by Governor Romney when he's made these arguments, when he's made this contention, which is interesting. I'm not so sure why Governor Romney did not rebut, because I don't think it's actually true. Or I should say, you have to make a lot of assumptions to get to that number, which I think each one of which can be debated. And now let me discuss that number. First of all, what the candidates have said much more concretely and pretty firmly is they're both against sequestration. President Obama is in favor of the roughly $500 billion or $487 in 10-year defense spending reductions that are codified in the Budget Control Act in the first tranche of cuts mandated by the Budget Control Act. For those of us who are from CBO or OMB or other such backgrounds, however, we know that $487 billion is measured against the previous Pentagon plan, which allowed for real growth in spending. And therefore, it might be more accurate to think of it as $350 billion in reductions, because that's measured against the CBO baseline, which is just an extrapolation of today's budget, you know, or actually back in starting in 2011, adjusting for inflation, but nothing else. Relative to that baseline, Obama's plan now is a little bit below, by about $350 billion. Governor Romney has said that he would reverse the Obama cuts. I assume that means primarily this Budget Control Act, this $487 billion reduction relative to the previous plan. It's also possible, however, and I haven't seen enough specificity from Governor Romney to be able to be sure, it's also possible that he would reverse the cuts made previously under Secretary Gates, which, as you know, came in two doses. Initially, what Gates did was keep the top line, the overall defense budget projection, the same, but he reallocated. He cut certain programs to free up available funds to fully fund others that had previously been underfunded. So that's not really a change in defense spending. That's reallocation. And then the second time around, Gates cut about $100 billion over 5 years in the actual top line relative to the previous projection. And if you do it over 10 years, let's say that's roughly $200 billion. So in other words, I'm sorry to delve into numbers. I promise I'm not going to throw them at you all night, although certainly this crowd's capable of digesting them. But my main point is, when I literally look at these two plans, I see a 10-year difference somewhere between 400 and some billion and 600 and some billion. However, President Obama said the difference is $2 trillion over that same time period. How does he get that number? I'm sure some of you know that if you go onto the Obama campaign website, this is not something the candidate talks about very much, and I'm not sure he ever has in the any time I've heard him speak. But if you go to the website, some of his defense team persuaded people to allow them to put on the website the aspirational goal of linking defense spending to GDP and keeping it at 4% indefinitely. Now, right now, defense spending is actually slightly more than 4% in outlay terms. I think it's going to be 4.2 or something in 2013. I think budget authority is just dipping ever so slightly below 4% in 2013, but we're right around 4. The Obama plan, however, because it's only going to grow the budget with inflation, actually a little bit less than that, it dwindles to about 3% of GDP by mid-decade. And Romney has said, aspirationally, he would keep it at 4%. Well, that's a funny word, aspirationally, right? Because what does that mean? You know, if all of a sudden our deficits and debts disappear and we can have whatever we want and each one of us gets a BMW, that's a nice aspiration, right? Johns Hopkins, why don't you provide us each a BMW to drive home tonight? That's a nice aspiration, too. I think the word aspiration is meant to mean I don't really mean it. I'm not going to have the money for it. Because certainly when I hear Romney speak in the debates, and I'm glad to hear him say this, he seems to care a lot about the deficit. And he also seems to recognize, when he's speaking to real voters, that too much talk of slashing entitlements, however much us budget weenies like myself might be happy to hear a little bit of that talk, most voters really don't enjoy it very much. And it's not a good way to win votes. And so it's not as if the governor has been sticking his chin out to say, I'm going to cut Social Security by a third. It's not what he's saying. He's trying very hard rhetorically to soften up any talk of entitlement reform. And the president avoids it altogether. So, in other words, we're going to have a heck of a time getting below these trillion-dollar deficits. And we all hear about, you know, who's going to cut taxes more for a higher percentage of the population is where the debate tends to go instead, as opposed to deficit reduction. So I think that any defense plan that is preceded by the word aspirational is close to meaningless. However, it's fair enough for President Obama to claim otherwise, to say, hey, I read your website. You want 4% of GDP for the 050 budget indefinitely into the future as a matter of policy. So I'm going to calculate my budget relative to yours. Although even here, the president took some liberties to get to $2 trillion, because what he basically did was he compared his own base budget to the 4% of Romney. He does not factor in war costs when he does that comparison. But last I checked, war costs were paid for in the defense budget. And so it seems that if you are comparing apples to apples, the Obama plan should include war costs, which admittedly are going to be a lot less, we hope, in the future than they've been. But still, that takes about $500 billion of that $2 trillion away by itself when you project out over 10 years. Anyway, I've probably thrown enough numbers at you. My point is, I think the real difference in spending levels between the two is probably somewhere around a half trillion over 10 years, not 2 trillion. Still enough money to make their positions distinctive and, you know, to make, it's a 10% differential in what the overall 10-year spending level is going to be, cumulatively, close to 10%. So that's real money. It's just not as much as the candidates themselves seem to want us to believe, because one guy wants to be the big, tough, hawkish guy, and the other one wants to be the prudent deficit reducer, and so they're allowing us all to see their differences and magnify them. But in reality, it strikes me that the differences, while big, are much more modest than that. So that's sort of contention number one. Now, let me say, I think before I get into the specifics of their programs and postures, some of which I'm sure you've been tracking as well, let me say a little word about what would actually happen if either one of them won as they interact with the Congress that's now, you know, either the lame duck or the next Congress. And we can try to do some political prognostication about what happens when these theoretical plans meet reality and go to Capitol Hill, and then have to get turned into law. And I'm not going to bore you with all, you didn't bring me here as some you know, political scientist who is expert at reading Congress and reading campaigns and candidates and translating their messages into what's likely to happen in their first 100 days. But I'm going to venture a couple minutes of speculation anyway, with apologies. And here's what I think. What I think is that if President Obama wins re-election, and I'd say that's probably, at this moment in time, a 55% likelihood, but what do I know about? It doesn't matter. Either one could win. But if President Obama wins re-election, he'll probably hold on to the Senate, but not regain the House. We probably still have a divided Congress. My prediction would be, just as the Washington Post wrote about today, there's a very high probability that the president will put in the old college try during the lame duck session, but actually be willing to see the fiscal cliff reached and jumped over, because he needs those tax cuts to go away, temporarily at least, to wipe the slate clean, so that Republican moderates can negotiate with him, even if they've signed Grover Norquist's pledge never to raise taxes. So what Obama needs is for the taxes to go up on their own because of the expiration of the law that had lowered them. And then as of January 1st, he has a clean slate. And I think the president, like the article today in the Post said, would then try to force a compromise in that early period. And I think he'd be willing to give a little bit. But he'd also be willing to go to the public and berate the Republicans and say, listen, I just won re-election. Sure, it was close, but I did win. And the Republicans need to accept that I won. Now, I recognize they still have one House of Congress, and we Democrats have the other. So when you add up the pieces, they've got one of the three key pieces here. We've got two of them. So presumably the compromise should be somewhere between, you know, 55 and 65% on our terms, 35 and 45% on theirs. Let's make a compromise. And let's do it for a 4-year period. Let's not, or a 10-year period. Let's not keep coming back to all these artificial crises over the debt and debt ceilings. And, you know, I think the president's had enough of that. And I think if he wins, he's going to try to use his mandate to put an end to that. And he'll try to appear reasonable to the voter and say he's carrying through on the mandate he just got and solve these problems while the vote, the November 6th vote is still fresh in people's minds and cannot be easily discounted by politicians who want to go back to their, you know, party's base, you know, sort of preferences. So I think the president would probably do a deal. And my guess is, in this deal, he would accept the necessity of some additional defense reductions above and beyond what's in the August 2011 initial Budget Control Act cuts, but much less deep than sequestration. And we've heard Senator Levin and Congressman Van Hollen both propose a number of around $100 billion over 10 years in additional cuts, on top of the 487, which, you know, again, 487 relative to the previous plan. More than the initial cuts that are currently in the books, currently the basis for Pentagon planning, but much less than the sequestration numbers of $500 billion in additional reductions would be. That's my guess about where the Democrats might wind up being very comfortable. And frankly, I think hawks in the Republican Party should take that number if they can get it, because given all the other things we're going to have to see cut in the budget in order to come anywhere close to balance, another $100 billion in a defense budget that remains, you know, 45% of global aggregate defense spending, you know, in the entirety of the planet, is still going to be looking like a pretty robust number. And for that number to wind up being the compromise would be pretty good. So I would predict that's about where the debate would go. Again, you'll have your chance at me in a second here. You can see this is a combination of analysis and political speculation, so I'm not suggesting you take my vision too seriously, but I'm putting it out there as a provocation. If Governor Romney wins, very briefly, what do I think will happen? Well, I think he'll have to reverse at least some of those Obama cuts, because that's what he said he would do. However, unless the Republicans sweep and take both houses of Congress, he will have a very powerful incentive not to push too hard to reverse all of those cuts, because he's still going to have a huge deficit problem. Have you looked at the numbers in the Romney plan and actually done the arithmetic? Neither one of these guys is Paul Tsongas or Ross Perot or Warren Rudman. And if you actually do the arithmetic, as the president's told us to do, unfortunately for the president, his own plan doesn't look that great, but Romney's does look a little worse. If you go to most neutral analysts on this, the Committee on a Responsible Federal Budget or various people in the think tanks who try to work through the numbers, Romney has a big deficit problem if he wins. And he just promised the country the other night that he's obviously, of course, going to achieve balance because he's done it every other thing he's done in his life, and of course he can do it again. A lot of governors have felt that way before they got into the White House in the past as well, and many of them have failed in that effort. But if Romney's half serious, and he doesn't want to anger every elderly voter in the country by slashing entitlements radically, he's going to have to be a little bit sparing about just how many of those Obama defense cuts he really reverses. So I would predict that just like President Obama is not going to really be all that concerned about whether he gets a deal in the lame duck session, because again, the fiscal cliff and the expiration of the tax cuts helps his bargaining position in January. Governor Romney, if he wins, is not really going to want to reverse all the all the Obama cuts. He's going to want to start out with a speech that says, that's my preference, that's my goal, and then immediately get into a negotiation with the Republicans and Democrats on Capitol Hill where he reverses some of them, but not all, because he's going to be worried about the deficit too. And he said he is worried about the deficit. So anyway, what I've now tried to do with my budget presentation, and as I wind up that part of the talk, what I try to suggest is that even rhetorically, the difference between Romney and Obama is actually less than we're hearing from the candidates themselves. And then when you actually imagine how they might govern, the difference probably narrows even more. But we're still looking at a world in which the defense budget will be under some pressure, I'll put it that way, regardless. And so we'll come back to that a little bit later and maybe in discussion. But now since I was asked tonight to talk about the candidates and what they've said and what they would do, not what I think they should do, or at least I'll save that for later, let me work through a little bit more of the positions they've established on specifics. So we know what President Obama's specifics are because he just did a new defense plan this past winter where he captured or tried to account for those $487 billion in cuts and come up with an alternative force posture and weapons modernization plan that would account for or lead to that much reduction in the previous plan. Now, he had to wave his hands, like everybody always does in this business, whenever they're trying to produce a Pentagon plan that stays within budget, which, as we know, is almost an oxymoron in the field that we are in. And one of the little devices that you'll recall, it was a very, you know, sort of almost cute and sweet little thing because it's been tried so many times before and it always works a little bit and never reaches anywhere near the goals set out for it, is that those $60 billion in unnamed efficiency savings, right? And of course, ever since I've been in this field, we've always got some new paradigm that's going to let us find magical savings. And in the 90s, it was privatization. Then privatization, which is still important in some ways, turned out to have been something we pushed too far once we saw all these private firms doing security operations in Iraq and Afghanistan. And we realized not only had it not saved us as much money as we hoped, but it actually caused us other problems. So there's always some new fad, some new concept. And most of them have some utility. And I realize there are contractors in this room who have done great work and squeezed out some savings for the taxpayer. I'm not trying to argue against privatization. I'm just saying these things are always built up to be bigger than they turn out to be. And so in the case of Obama's latest plan and those $60 billion in savings, there wasn't even really a serious theory about how they could be achieved. They didn't even try to justify. They just said, we'll find them. Except everybody's been trying to find them for decades, and they're hard to find. I remember, I see my good friend Mike Berger in the audience. We both worked for Bob Hale at the Congressional Budget Office 20 years ago. Bob, of course, is now the comptroller of the Pentagon. Bob wrote a wonderful paper about 8 years ago when he was out of government. And he did it for Andy Krepinevich's shop, CSBA. And as I recall, the title of it was something like, Efficiencies in the Defense Business Accounts. Be realistic, but keep trying. And I love the title. And I think it's exactly right for how we should think about these. And the paper itemized the way in which we could aspire to save 100 million here and 100 million there with various kinds of efficiencies. And now poor old Bob Hale has the job of trying to find 60 billion in these kinds of efficiencies. And by the way, that assumes that number would be bigger, except it assumes that all of our weapons are no longer going to grow in cost, because that's what any Pentagon planning shop does when it's told to hold its appetite under control. It acknowledges all the budget cost increases that have happened previously, but it assumes like weapons like the F-35 or whatever are going to not grow any further in cost, in unit cost. And therefore, all the cost growth is now done. We're going to bring things in on budget. And of course, this never turns out to be true. And there are dozens of defense studies over the years from the OMBs and RANs and CBOs and GAOs that document how much the FYDP is always underfunded relative to how much you would need to pay for all the forces and weapons modernization plans that are within that FYDP, that five-year plan. Or in this case, of course, we're talking about a 10-year plan. So my point is that, quick summary of this argument, that in fact, President Obama is going to have a hard time reaping $487 billion himself, even with the reductions that he's proposed. But what are those reductions? Well, as you know, he wants to bring the ground forces down in size by a cumulative total of about 100,000 active duty troops, Army and Marines. Interestingly, the Army and the Marine Corps would still remain slightly larger than they had been in the 1990s, even after these cuts are complete. And even with Saddam Hussein and his overland threat to Kuwait and other neighbors now gone. So we can come back to that as to whether or not that is a sufficiently austere or sufficiently rigorous kind of reform to the size of the ground forces, but that's one data point. He looked for a few weapon systems, like the latest variant of Global Hawk and a transport airplane that wasn't performing as well as hoped, but not the C-17, it was the C-30, right, or C-27. And he found ways to argue to retire or cancel a couple of programs of that magnitude. But otherwise, the modernization agenda was stretched out a little, but emerged remarkably unscathed from this $487 billion budget-cutting exercise. And again, I'm a little dubious as to whether that's as far as we can push reforms on major weapons platforms, but that is what the president did. He tried to stretch things out, and he canceled a couple of systems that were not particularly promising and also not particularly loved by big parts of any service, to be blunt. And then, of course, there were some reductions proposed for military pay increases, a couple other things within the personnel accounts, and some modest reductions in force structure. A couple of Navy ships retired, I think a few, maybe a half dozen squadrons of Air Force aircraft. And that's basically the Obama 10-year plan. That's where the reductions came from. So to first approximation, you would have to assume that Governor Romney is going to reverse most of those, because he's reversing the budget cuts, at least in theory. At least his his actual plan, as announced, would reverse them. But of course, Governor Romney has also said that he does want to reverse the ground force reductions. He wants to restore the levels that we had in 07, 08, 09. And then he wants to make a bigger Navy, and he wants to maintain greater carrier presence in the broader Middle East with that larger Navy. And I think those are the main specifics that we've heard the governor talk about. So you can probably help me in the discussion period with one or two other smaller things he said, but those are the big ones. And part of the reason why there are so few specifics is because President Obama actually hadn't really cut that much. Of a major visibility. He had stretched things out. He had nibbled away at the edges of the force structure. He had gotten rid of a couple of systems people didn't really like or think were that good anyway. So instead of just saying, I'm going to make a big deal out of restoring the production line for this or that system, Governor Romney chose not to bother with that kind of rhetoric, because it wasn't like Obama killed the F-35 or something, or the littoral combat ship. He killed the C-27 and the Block 30 Global Hawk, or things like that, which are still important systems, and maybe they were bad or wrong decisions. I don't, I don't have a strong view myself, tend to support the decisions, but you can debate them. But they are not big ticket items that are going to resonate, you know, while you're debating the other presidential candidate in the course of a nationally televised event. It doesn't rise to that level of visibility. So what the governor's basically done is to say just three or four specific things. I want to reverse the planned cuts in ground forces and keep them where they've been. I want to build up the Navy substantially. And now John Lehman's talking about a 350-ship Navy. And the governor is talking more about building 15 ships a year instead of 9, comparing that to the Obama plan. And at least at a minimum, you would assume they want to get to the Roughhead Greenert aspirational levels of 315 or 313 ships or 325, sort of depends which speech you look at. But those have been the numbers the recent CNOs have been pushing. And I think that if the governor were serious, because he has been very specific on the Navy, it sounds like he might be serious, there's a good chance that he'll move a substantial distance in the direction of a larger Navy. Obviously, it takes time to build ships. It's going to be the end of his first term before he's probably seen any increase in the actual number of deployed vessels, because it's going to take a while to phase this in and build the things. But I think he seems like he means it. And then, again, this point, I was wondering if his real purpose in this was to get tough with China. But interestingly, even though he wants to get tough with China economically, and there's a lot of debate about that, China as a military threat doesn't play a big role in the governor's debate performances or speeches such as I've heard them. I listened to him speak at VMI 10 days ago, obviously watched both debates, have listened to other foreign policy and defense speeches that he's given over the years. He certainly has people in his team who are very concerned about the rise of China, very hawkish towards China. And occasionally, he'll let on about that. But it was, after all, Russia that he called our top geostrategic threat, not China, and not Iran, and not Al-Qaeda. So it was sort of interesting how he actually is distinguishing between going to the mat with China economically, but avoiding incendiary rhetoric on the military front. And frankly, I think that's probably relatively smart politics. And probably relatively smart strategy, too. But it is notable to me that when he's talked about what he would do with this bigger Navy, and again, I want to invite those of you who might have listened to speeches I didn't track or to previous debates in the Republican primaries where he said things that he hasn't repeated since that are at least worth mentioning. But for the most part, he's only talked about changing the way he operates in the Middle East, in the Persian Gulf Middle East region. And as you know, he wants to have a carrier both in the Persian Gulf and in the Eastern Med all the time, which is greater than we've been maintaining recently, although not by a lot, as Navy friends, I'm sure, can attest. And they, you know, it's been taken out of their hides that we've maintained such a high op tempo in the broader Persian Gulf region. I think the latest statistics I saw, we've been averaging 1.6 or 1.7 carrier deployments at a time in the broader Middle East region. Romney would go to 2. Obama's been at 1.6, 1.7. Again, this is not exactly, you know, a distinction between a Richard Nixon and a George McGovern or a, you know, Barney Frank and a John McCain. I mean, these are a little more narrow in terms of what the differences would seem to imply, but still non-trivial. Non-trivial differences about the size of the Navy, about the size of the defense budget, and about the size of the Army and Marine Corps. So I can now conclude the second part of the talk, because that's all the candidates have given me to go on. Again, that's sort of all the grist I've got for trying to focus on the differences between them. And, you know, I could itemize all the similarities, but what that basically means is I'm just repeating existing policy, because we're currently in the Obama administration, and we currently live with the Obama defense plan and force posture. So I'm not going to bore this audience itemizing all the specific things we're already doing, buying, and maintaining, because you know as well as I what those are. And so the differences are where the things are more interesting. I guess it is worth mentioning one more thing, which is missile defense, and maybe the broader question of nukes, although nuclear weapons. Although they haven't been very specific. You have to start to infer from their comments. But when the New START treaty was signed a few years ago, and then we had the ratification debate in the lame duck session of 2010, and ultimately the Senate ratified the treaty. Mitt Romney was very adamantly opposed to that, if you may recall. He wrote a very strident op-ed in the Washington Post in which he said this was a bad treaty, which put him at odds with basically every former Republican Secretary of Defense and State, or all but one or two maybe, but 80 to 90% of the surviving cabinet level previous Republicans, as well as, I think, President Bush. Although I can't remember if Bush actually was very emphatic in what he said, but certainly previous Secretaries of State and Defense from the GOP thought the treaty was a reasonable way to go. They may not have all been jumping up and down with enthusiasm over it. They may not have thought it was that important, but they were not against it. Romney made the case that it was actually bad for our security. So regardless of where you come down on that issue, you might conclude that Romney's not going to be enthusiastic about another round of nuclear arms control. However, Vladimir Putin's probably not enthusiastic about it either, and it's going to be a hard sell. A colleague of mine at Brookings, Steve Pfeiffer, and I, we just wrote and published a short book on what we hope the next president will do on the nuclear arms control agenda. And we think there is a case to be made for both Russia and the U.S. that this would be in both of our interests to start to capture tactical and surplus weapons and bring total warheads down to 2,500, bring strategic count down to 1,000. That's the basic concept we lay out. And we think it would save money for both sides, and it would still preserve parity and, for both, and then great superiority for each against any other potential adversary. So we hope that, you know, the conventional wisdom is wrong on this, but the conventional wisdom is Vladimir Putin doesn't want any more nuclear arms control, whether Romney or Obama wins. We'll have to see. But they're not debating this in any kind of detail. It's not like Romney wants to reopen the MX missile production line or anything like that, or take those four Trident submarines that we converted into cruise missile and special force carriers and return them to the days of carrying Tridents or something like that, or now build a new nuclear warhead for deep penetration of underground targets. We're not hearing any of that in this campaign. And so I think the specifics on nuclear weapons have to be inferred from debates of 2 years ago. And that's, you know, pretty conjectural, even by the standards of this talk you're putting up with tonight. And so I'm not going to make too much of it. But the one last thing, I think it's probably fair to conclude on missile defense in Europe and what you know is called the phased adaptive approach for Europe, which President Obama now has begun to deploy in a four-stage sequence. And the ultimate and the final piece of this would be missile interceptors and radars in Poland and the Czech Republic in 2018. That would be the fourth phase. That's the phase the Russians hate. That's the plan, that's the part of the plan that looks sort of like what we had under President Bush. And then Secretary Gates and President Obama decided they had a better plan, and Gates took the heat. He said, you know, don't give Obama too much credit or Bush too much criticism. I was the Secretary of Defense for both of these plans, and the reason we're changing is we found a better plan. The phased adaptive approach is just a little bit more technologically effective, and it gives us a deployment in the shorter term to give us some interim capability. And hopefully it makes the Russians less angry, which appeared to be the case at least for a while. And so it's win-win-win. And Gates said, you know, so don't make this into some big high-level Democratic-Republican fight. It's just, you know, evolving and improving policy. That was Gates's contention. I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but I think that's basically what he argued. And but now we've heard President Obama in an inopportune comment in Korea a few months ago say to Mr. Medvedev, don't worry, I'll have more flexibility to deal with these issues after the election. He didn't say what he meant, but presumably he meant something. And then Governor Romney, picking up on that, said in his convention speech that with me, Vladimir Putin's going to have a little less flexibility and run into a little more American backbone. So I assume they're disagreeing probably on the fourth piece of the phased adaptive approach. But I'm just guessing because they didn't say. They didn't say what flexibility towards Putin meant or didn't mean. Okay, so that's as far as I can go towards identifying real differences. In other words, once again, the theme of my talk is the differences would appear to be less than one might have ascertained or deduced by watching the debates and listening to the rhetoric of the candidates, where I think they're trying to magnify their differences on these issues whenever they do speak about them. That's sort of the temptation politically, it would appear. Final topic, and I'll try to get through this fairly briefly and then hopefully have a lot of time for discussion. But again, I don't think you can give a talk on the defense budget of two potential presidents when there are several looming potential military interventions without discussing those, because obviously if we wind up in another war, depending on its size, we could be talking about anywhere from a, you know, $20 to $200 billion a year additional expense for that operation alone, which begins to become real money relative to all these other things we're talking about, in addition to having great national security significance. So what can we, and again, the theme is going to be, I'm going to try very hard to identify some differences, but they're not as big as one might think when one candidate's trying to say, you know, yeah, I'm the guy who killed bin Laden, but I'm also the guy who's ending the wars, and I'm basically reverting back to a more peacenik kind of rhetoric. And the other guy's trying to say, the energy's out of your foreign policy, you can't even protect our diplomats anymore, Mr. President, and I'm the real hawk, and, you know, let's try to portray this debate a little bit like Republican-Democratic national security debates used to be in the Cold War, because we all know you guys deep down really are the wimps, and we're really the tough guys. The candidates sort of want to make things sound that way to some extent. But now let's look at what they're actually saying, case by case and country by country. Well, on Syria, let me start with Syria. I don't know if you've been following this, but it's been sort of interesting. There were a couple of Romney advisors who at one point this summer said, if Romney wins, he's going to arm the Syrian opposition. President Obama has not wanted to, and President Romney would. And we see the Syrian opposition, yeah, they're getting a few weapons in from Saudi Arabia right now, and Qatar, and UAE, and we help train them on the weapons maybe a little bit or coordinate the delivery, but we're playing a very low-key role, partly to avoid disruption perhaps to the U.S.-Russia relationship and to keep our powder dry if we can play a role of negotiating a power-sharing deal. At least that might have been the initial logic behind our restraint. And some of these Romney advisors said, well, let's arm the opposition, which is a pretty standard American tactic when we don't want to get involved ourselves. There were a lot of proxy wars during the Cold War. We did this in Afghanistan, obviously, in the 1980s. Bob Dole made this a big part of his disagreement with Bill Clinton on Bosnia, as you'll recall, back in 93, 94. And it's a legitimate thing to debate, because we obviously can have some impact on a conflict by arming one side or another, especially if we help them use the weapons well. But interestingly, so it didn't seem like a crazy idea, and it didn't seem like a dramatic proposal. He wasn't talking about even a no-fly zone. And yet, even that turned out to be too much. And the campaign pulled back. And now the official position of the Romney campaign is sort of, and I'm not mocking them. I am sort of teasing both candidates here, as you can see, on the way these debates sometimes get amplified in a political season. I'm trying to be a little bit, farcical, just for the sake of provoking a discussion with all of you, and just because it's some good comic relief after we're all going through these burdensome processes of watching all these debates and reading all this stuff. I think they deserve to sometimes be teased a little bit. But the main point is, humor aside, that Romney does not want to get too far beyond Obama's position, because he himself does not talk about the United States arming the Syrian opposition. He talks about being a little more effective and forward-leaning in getting our allies to do it for us, which may be a meaningful difference. Again, I'm not trying to say that just because these differences are modest, they're unimportant. But it's a lot less than you would expect. And for all the kind of interventions we've done over the last 20, 30, 40, 50 years in this country, to have the debate be confined to that very narrow part of the spectrum where Obama doesn't want to arm the opposition, but is willing to help them train up on certain kinds of weapons. Romney also doesn't want to arm the opposition, also doesn't want to do a no-fly zone, also doesn't want to support the Turks in the creation of a safe zone in northern Syria for refugees, also doesn't want to put American boots on the ground. And now he also doesn't want to arm the Syrian opposition either. He just wants to try a little harder to persuade the Saudis to do it for us. This is a pretty modest difference of opinion. What they would do if elected, you can try to read their souls and their political philosophies and take, your gauge of each man and figure out whether they would really be so close a year from now. And maybe Romney's the kind of guy who will be very assertive once he's in office. And he's minimizing the rhetoric right now to avoid, stirring up an issue the American people don't really want to hear about. Because if he talks about getting more assertive in Syria, it's not too far of a stretch to believe that maybe he would be willing to do a no-fly zone or a no-go zone, or even boots on the ground if the first effort fails. So he seems to want to not touch that with a 10-foot pole. Maybe he would be more resolute once in office. Or maybe President Obama, who took a lot of pride in the success of the Libya mission, took a lot of pride in the success of the bin Laden raid, would ultimately feel some guilt as we watch Syrian civilians continue to get slaughtered before our eyes and we do nothing about it, nothing to speak of. So maybe, my guess is both these guys over time get pushed towards doing more than they're talking about right now. You may be able to help me in the discussion figure out which one would be more apt to do it. I don't know. I can't really form a serious theory. I don't have enough to go on because I see certain elements of resoluteness but also certain elements of restraint in both of them. And I don't know how to parse the differences. But maybe some people have said, well, there's a bigger difference on Afghanistan. And certainly there was a big difference the other night in the vice presidential debate, it seemed, for a few minutes anyway, right? Because Vice President Biden seemed to want to be suggesting that Congressman Ryan and Governor Romney would keep our forces in Afghanistan longer than Clinton and than Obama and Biden would. And he kept coming back to that point. In 2014, we're out of there. Except that's not President Obama's policy. And so I was a little surprised that Congressman Ryan didn't pick up on this point, because it's not the first time that Vice President Biden has publicly taken a different position on the Afghanistan war than President Obama. And I like Joe Biden in many ways, and I understand where he's coming from on Afghanistan, but he must know that when President Obama flew to Kabul on May 1st to sign a strategic partnership agreement with President Karzai this year, just 5 months ago, the whole goal of that partnership was to extend our presence in Afghanistan beyond 2014, militarily, economically, and diplomatically, but including military means. Now, we haven't worked out a status of forces agreement with President Karzai or other Afghans yet, and we may not. President Karzai may do the same thing to us that the Afghan parliament or the Iraqi parliament did and not offer terms that are acceptable. And so it may well be that we wind up leaving, but it will be sort of a replay of Iraq where our stated position was we wanted to stay, and then ultimately politics in the country at issue prevented us from doing so. But the stated position of President Obama right now is he wants a successful negotiation on the status of forces so that we can extend our partnership beyond 2014. Yes, the mission will change. And if Joe Biden were here tonight and he needed to rebut me, that's what he would say. He'd be like, come on, Mike. The mission's going to change. It's going to be a lot smaller, a lot different. It's going to be just 10,000 Americans. Right now it's 70,000, and we're out there patrolling. And the 10,000 are going to be primarily providing support and intelligence and occasionally some special operations help. It's night and day. Don't pretend that it's continuity. And on all those points, he would be right, except he said we'll be out of Afghanistan in 2014, which is factually not the position of the Obama administration right now. And Congressman Ryan let him get away with it. So anyway, we can all try to deduce the political motives of those two gentlemen to say what they did. Clearly, Biden recognizes that Americans are sick of this war, and he wanted to be as emphatic as he could be. And my guess is, politically, he got the better part of the argument in the debate. Whether it was good for the nation's Afghanistan policy down the road or not, I don't know, and I'm a little worried. But probably politically, he said what people wanted to hear. But the fact of the matter is, they both recognize, as does the whole rest of the NATO alliance and the Afghan president, that 2014 is the year when the current NATO mission, the ISAF mission, ends. We will have transferred primary security responsibility in most of the country to the Afghans well before that. But we all know the Afghan security forces are not capable yet of doing it on their own. So even in places where they have lead responsibility, they still need our help. And therefore, you can't really say how fast the drawdown should go from today to the end of 2014. Neither one of the candidates has said whether he leans towards what seemed to be General Allen's preference when he testified a few months ago, which was that, you know, 68,000 would be a nice number to assume as a starting point and maybe stay near in 2013. And General Allen very very carefully and very professionally found nice language to make that point that, yeah, he had a preference to stay high, but it wasn't his decision to make, and the decision had not yet been made. And as he put it, I owe the president some analysis on that question. And he's doing that analysis right now because we've completed the first drawdown. And Governor Romney has not wanted to make any big deal out of this. He hasn't wanted to take Allen's previous testimony and say, I will commit to keep 68,000 troops in Afghanistan next year if my commanders request it. How about you, Mr. President? Romney didn't want to do that. He did say, I'll listen to the commanders. But he avoided, and I'll listen to them more than you will, Mr. President, because you've already disregarded their advice in a couple of previous instances, and I won't do that. But he avoided any talk of numbers. because he doesn't want to be seen as supporting an unpopular war and keeping our troops there longer than necessary. So again, Romney feels a little more resolute and hawkish on this, if those are the right words, but not very much. And a lot of us thought, and a lot of us who support the mission in Afghanistan still, worried that President Obama would have cut forces already again by now, because it was June 2011 when he announced the reduction to 68,000. And I've been relieved and impressed that the president did not announce any additional reductions yet. He allowed that process to play itself out. He's waiting for General Allen to do his analysis. He's waiting until after the election to talk about any more specificity on a drawdown. So he has a little more patience than his rhetoric might imply, because he wants to sound like the guy who's ending the war already. And his vice president says, we are ending the war, and we're out of there in 2 years. Meanwhile, so you know, you can make the case that Obama's position is a little bit nuanced. And similarly, Romney, while he sounds a little more resolute at times, a little more stay the course, doesn't want to be too concrete or specific about keeping 68,000 troops, our current number, there for any particular period of time. He just wants to say he's going to listen to the commanders in making his decision. Again, I don't see much difference. So you can tell me which one is meaningfully more or less committed to this mission than the other. But unfortunately, this fits with the theme of my talk, that there's not a big difference. So let me finish, finally, on the case of Iran. Maybe have we finally found the one case where we can really say there's a big difference, and that under Obama, we would probably avoid war, and under Romney, we're going to be in another big war with the biggest country of any of the countries we fought since 1953, right? If we fight Iran, it will be the biggest opponent we had since we fought the Chinese in the Korean War. It'd be a pretty big deal. And it would presumably trump a lot of these decisions on C-27s and, you know, Global Hawk Block 30 in terms of their cosmic significance or their budgetary impact. So maybe I should finish on this. And again, this will be a good provocation, because I'm sure you're all following what the candidates say on these questions, and you may read it differently than I do. But here's how I read it. And again, the bottom line is going to be Romney is slightly more hawkish, but only to a degree that is barely detectable, and I can't therefore use it to give me a lot of predictive power as to what he would do in office. Here's why I reached that conclusion. President Obama himself, if he's really the dove on this issue, and he's the guy who doesn't want to be the second great preemptor in the Middle East, because after all, he ran against George W. Bush's foreign policy. He didn't run against George W. Bush, but he sure as heck did run against George W. Bush's legacy, and he made that very clear. And wouldn't it be the supreme irony if Barack Obama turned out to be the second great American preemptor of the 21st century in regard to Middle Eastern weapons of mass destruction programs? Now, admittedly, it would be two different types of preemptions. And so you might say, there's no way Obama's going to go along with this. And even Bush stopped the Israelis from striking Iran, so presumably Obama would too. But then, of course, you look at some of the various statements President Obama's made. He's always said an Iranian nuclear weapon would be unacceptable. This spring, he said even more emphatically, containment is not an option, and we will prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. And he said that with the active voice. We will prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon, which sure made it sound to me like some of the people in this room or your services could be involved in that mission, not just asking the Israelis to do our work for us. That's Obama. So he really, you know, depending on which statement you refer to, he sounds pretty hawkish at times on Iran. Okay, but you might say, well, sure, but that was just rhetoric. And when you look at Romney, he's consistent. He really despises the idea of a nuclear-armed Iran. He's, you know, his convention speech, many other places, he's been extremely clear that he will do whatever it takes to prevent this. Fine, except when he went to Israel and he gave a speech this summer, what did he say? That he's not going to interfere with Prime Minister Netanyahu exercising his sovereign rights as the leader of an independent country to conduct a military operation that he feels is necessary for his own state's security. In other words, he did not propose an American preemptive action under his presidency. He proposed that maybe, if all else fails, it wouldn't be so bad if Netanyahu did it. I'm not suggesting that's the entirety of Obama or of Romney's thinking on the subject. Maybe Governor Romney would, in fact, carry out a preemption himself if certain things transpired. But when I look at these two campaigns, two candidates, and I actually put down all the things they say about Iran and try to make sense of them, the first takeaway is I'm not sure I can make sense of them. The second is I'm not sure who really is the more hawkish. And by the way, this is not a criticism, because if anything, I'm slightly to their left. I'm not sure it would make sense to preempt Iran unless Iran went so far as to actually just kick out the weapons inspectors and go straight to 90% enrichment, and we saw them doing it. And it was just a matter of a couple of months. But most of the talk about possibly using military force does not presume the IAEA being kicked out. It just presumes Iran accumulating more uranium of 20% enrichment. And the debate is over whether we strike under those circumstances. And I'm not necessarily in favor of that myself. So I'm not trying to criticize them. I'm just acknowledging the paradox or the conundrum they're both in. We don't really want war with Iran. We don't really want an Iranian nuclear weapon. We're hoping, we're all desperately hoping, the sanctions squeeze leads to a negotiated deal. And probably either guy would give more by way of a compromise in such a deal than he's letting on publicly. Probably either guy would let Iran keep some of its centrifuges and some of its enriched uranium if we could at least cap how much more they developed in the future and got some of the existing uranium out or some of the existing centrifuges disbanded and dismantled. So on this one again, and this is a good place to stop because you're probably itching to tell me all the places where I read these guys wrong, but on this one again, I don't see big differences. So the conclusion I have is I think you should vote for your choice of president based on domestic and economic policy, because for all their efforts to make a big foreign policy difference between the two, I don't see much difference at all, and probably the least difference that I've seen in my adult lifetime between two major candidates. That may be, maybe we can challenge that one, but I can't think of another example of where the two candidates were actually so close on most major issues. So I'll leave it at that and look forward very much to your thoughts. Thanks.
Thank you. Just a few rules on the question and answer. Please wait for the microphone to come to you so we can hear your question because we're recording it. Please slowly state your name and affiliation. No acronyms, please. One question only per person. And please keep the context of your question short so we can maximize the time for the answer. Thank you.
Paul Kazemchak, Department of Defense. I have a question about red lines. In my professional career, I've never heard a sitting president or secretary of defense use the phrase red lines as often as President Obama and Secretary Panetta. We have red lines in the Straits of Hormuz. We have red lines on the Iranian program. We have red lines on Assad's use of chemical weapons. Two questions. Has there been any response from Governor Romney? I haven't heard him use that phrase at all or anything resembling it. And second, do we have the forces under the budget conditions that you've described to enforce those red lines? For example, in the worst case, and to use the old contingency planning guidance, we could be staring at the equivalent of two major regional conflicts, major regional wars, both involving weapons of mass destruction, wars against Iran on two fronts, they're going to fight to the last Syrian, wars with the Syrians, and wars with Lebanese, with Hezbollah, and all their assorted proxies all over the globe. How are you reading that?
Yeah, thank you. Good questions. On the issue of red lines, I think that Governor Romney has essentially used similar language about both Iran and Syria. Because on Syria, he agreed with President Obama that the use of chemical weapons would essentially be something we could not accept. I'll come back in a second to what we would do about it, because that's I'm glad you asked, and I think I only have a partial answer. But on Iran, they both made it clear that an Iranian nuclear weapon would be unacceptable, which is another way of saying red line. But they've also implied that their red line would be before that. That Iran's already, the way I like to talk about it is it's sort of a red zone. Iran's sort of in the red zone and they're moving down the field. The red line is the goal line. They may or may not get there. If they get there, then I guess we have to strike, except that it's too late in some ways, right? But it's when they're in the red zone that the question becomes, at what point do you really act? So these guys say red line when they mean red zone, when they mean we're in a very dangerous place, but there's sort of a continuum of worsening conditions. I don't know that Governor Romney's used that expression as much, but I think he's in a very similar place on Iran, where they both wanted to say, this has already gone on way too far, and Romney's basically said, if Netanyahu wants to attack tomorrow, I'm not going to stand in his way, which implies he's already uncomfortable with where Iran is today, but Iran has not actually crossed over that last threshold. that's truly been declared unacceptable by both men, Romney and Obama. And so on the Straits of Hormuz, I think it's pretty clear that any American president in the last 40 years would fight to keep them open. And so I don't know, that may be a different semantic formulation. I'm not sure it's a different policy. But let me come back to Syria. It's an interesting point you raised about what could we do about it and how many wars are we going to be in simultaneously if we do. And it strikes me that the most obvious thing to say would be that if Assad started to use chemical weapons, he'd presumably be using airplanes and artillery to deliver them. Maybe there are other means that he would do as well, which implies that we will do a no-fly zone and strike large objects. So it becomes more like Bosnia 95. I think that becomes the implied military mission for the United States. And my guess is that it's too late now for either Romney or Obama to back away from doing that much, if indeed Assad were to use chemical weapons. And of course, that means if I were a Syrian insurgent, I would have a perverse desire to see Assad do just that. Because the minute we impose a no-fly zone and we start striking artillery, we're going to do a lot more than hamper their ability to use chemical weapons. We're going to weaken them conventionally as well, because we're not going to be able to know what kind of artillery shell is loaded into that howitzer, so we're going to have to assume it might be chemical. You know, and I guess you could always say, President Assad, we're going to strike you until you stop using chemicals, but when you go back to just shelling those neighborhoods full of women and children with regular high explosive, that's okay, we'll back off. I think there's too much of an oxymoron associated with that. And so if we get involved because of chemical weapons use, I don't believe we can then pull ourselves out, even if Assad promises to stop the chemicals. So I think at that point, our intervention has begun, and it will continue until Assad's out. So that's why I think it's an effective, credible threat. If the Syrian military has thought this through, if Assad's thought it through, he'll realize it really is, in this case, a red line that we mean. And it's one that he doesn't really want to play around with. But I take your point. It is, I think with Iran in particular, it's not an accurate phraseology. Whether there's anything better to do at this point, I'm not sure. Good question. Thank you.
Sorry, Bob McCrae, George Washington University. How would you rank the candidates in terms of their approaches to China and Russia from a strategic standpoint over the next 3 or 4 years, given the changes in possible leadership from the Politburo in China, as well as Putin being around for at least another 3 or 4 years? How do you compare these two candidates on that?
Yeah, thank you. And I probably should have spent a little more time on the Russia piece in particular. On China, I don't see a big difference. They're both, to use President Obama's phrase, as was quoted in this beautiful little book my colleague Jeff Bader wrote when he came out of the Obama administration. He had been the senior director at the NSC for East Asia, and he wrote a book at Brookings called Obama and China's Rise. And he quotes the president as saying, you know, it's time for us to throw a few more elbows towards China economically. And I think we're seeing both candidates talk to an American public that's uneasy about, obviously, the state of our own economy, unsure about whether Chinese manufacturing is taking away American jobs, and therefore willing to throw a few elbows itself. You know, both are trying to gain some political support for a more economically confrontational policy. And yet they both know there's only so much you can do. So I don't think there's any huge disagreement. I mean, Romney said he would declare China a currency manipulator on his first day. You know, on the other hand, China's currency has gone up in value 13% or something under Obama, and I'm not sure, therefore, that Romney's going to accomplish that much more with that approach. So I think Russia maybe is the more striking difference, and I probably should have addressed that more in my talk. That may be one of the places where they have a meaningful difference, because it does sound to me like Obama's actually doing a very sort of Nixonian or Kissingerian thing on Russia. He's establishing priorities, and he's disciplining his policy in keeping with those priorities. And frankly, Russian democracy and Russian human rights are lower priorities than getting Russian help on Iran and Afghanistan. And that's very clear for Obama. And also, Russian help on Syria is probably even less than getting Russian help on Iran and Afghanistan. And Obama's been very disciplined in a way that, you know, Jim Baker is probably proud of. It's a very classic realist approach. Let's not expect that we can transform Russian society or beat up on them over every human rights thing. We're going to have to be a little bit more discriminating in terms of what we can get from Moscow. And I think Obama wants to, he feels very proud of the Russia reset policy, even though it's in a little bit of trouble right now, even though it hasn't really had a good 2012. But let's not forget, 2012, the first 5 months of 2012, the Pakistanis allowed us no access through their territory to Afghanistan, and we still kept fighting the war. And the reason is that Vladimir Putin did let us go through the north in six or seven different ways. You know, there are six or seven different aspects of the northern distribution network that we've developed over the years that is partly a culmination of Obama's reset policy. At least you could argue that. So my guess is that Obama's going to try to see if he can't rebuild the relationship with Putin, and he'll be willing to overlook some of Putin's weaknesses and flaws and domestic, you know, domestic mistakes and brutalities, frankly, in the process, because that's been his policy. Romney and Putin, however, might do really badly together. I could see that being a really bad relationship, because if there's one thing that I really think gets Vladimir Putin's hair up on the back of his neck, it's Americans acting like the hegemon. I mean, you know, I have two colleagues at Brookings who wrote this beautiful book on Putin that's coming out in a couple of months, and it talks about the evolution of his character and the different personalities that are part of his makeup. You know, and he's the former KGB guy, so he grew up as a big opponent of the United States. And he's also the head of a country he sees as a great power. He said, you know, the dissolution of the Soviet Union was the worst tragedy of the 20th century. And he obviously regrets the day when Russia could be seen as a superpower. He hates it when America seems to run the world, when it gets a UN Security Council resolution to protect Libyan civilians and uses that with its allies to overthrow Gaddafi, you know, when it now seems bent on doing something similar in Syria. This sort of stuff really sets Putin off. I think President Obama wants to manage that relationship, recognizing that it's not a very happy one, whereas I think Mitt Romney might get off to a very bad start. Now, maybe over time, Romney's bad start would turn out to yield dividends. I don't know. Maybe Putin would realize that it's not worth the trouble of having such an adversarial relationship with the United States. But my guess is that Putin doesn't really need us to be nice to him, and he's willing to have a bad relationship if that's what we want, and that he will be willing to be a lot less cooperative on Iran, on North Korea, on Afghanistan, if he finds himself being unduly challenged by the United States. So I guess I'm revealing my own views here. I think Obama's policy is smarter, but I think there is a difference, regardless of whose you like better, on that issue in particular. So thanks for asking.
I'm Becky Roberts from the National Intelligence University, and I noticed a gap in your first story, which is, what if Obama were to retain a presidency, but neither of the houses were of his party? So that would be a different angle of flight. Could you talk to that a little?
That's an interesting question. Yeah, and let's just posit that scenario for the sake of argument. I don't think it's very likely, or I would have felt obliged to address it. But you're right, it can't be dismissed. Presumably, in that case, Republicans will have two things to figure out, and they may not be the same. One is, what's our public messaging about the election and who really won? And the second is, what do they think the real outcome of the election means deep down, and what they say to themselves, and when they are plotting out political tactics? And my guess is that if Obama wins re-election and he squeaks it out over Romney, but the Republicans wind up with both houses of Congress, a lot of Republicans will say, we basically won the election, and we would have swept the whole thing if we had had a better candidate. Because we all know that until the last couple of weeks, a lot of Republicans didn't really like Mitt Romney as a candidate. They thought he was weak. They thought he emerged from a field of relatively weak candidates. that he was too moderate for the time, and therefore he had to sort of seem more extreme than he really was, and that made him seem like a flip-flopper. And whether you sympathize with, I actually like Mitt Romney. I think he's a genuine moderate, and I say that as a compliment. But obviously in the party that he needed to get the nomination from, which was energized by the Tea Party movement and very angry with the president, moderation was not really the going style a year ago. So Romney had to tack to the right to win the nomination. And a lot of Republicans think that therefore he wound up feeling or sounding or looking like a little bit of a flip-flopper on a lot of issues, starting with the health care subject and going from there. So a lot of Republicans will conclude if they actually win both houses of Congress, but Romney loses the presidential race, they'll still say Americans prefer Republicans to Democrats. And we don't want to give an inch to the president in somehow conceding that he won the election, because the Congress is an equal part of our government to the executive branch in terms of its constitutional powers. So that's what Republicans will think, I believe. And it might be true. Then they'll have to decide, okay, how confrontational do we want to be with Obama? And how is that going to play? And that's a separate question. And frankly, I don't have a good answer on that one in my own head. The last 4 years would lead you to believe they're going to be pretty tough as negotiators. I mean, we go back to Mitch McConnell's statement early in 2009, our number one goal is to make sure Barack Obama's a one-term president. That's a pretty strident statement and reflects and reveals perhaps quite a bit. And of course, McConnell would presumably still be in leadership in this scenario of yours, and Eric Cantor would still be in leadership, and they would perhaps feel energized by the outcome of the election. So my guess is they're going to try to double down on their positions, and if anything, feel like the election was a slight mandate for them compared to the politics of before. So that could lead to a real showdown at OK Corral, especially because both sides are starting with budget plans that don't add up. And usually when you get two sides that are fighting, what survives are the worst parts of their plans, right? Because the worst parts of their plans are the more politically popular. So Republicans are probably going to really fight hard for their tax cuts. Democrats really fight hard for no entitlement reform. And you know, it's almost, in some ways, the worst outcome of the election I could imagine. I've probably ruined a lot of your nights, but you've just helped ruin mine because you scared me. You've really made me feel like if that comes to pass, I don't see how we get a budget deal, because I think both sides are going to overrate the strength of their hand. And hopefully I'm wrong.
Tony Smith, Olmsted Foundation. Foreign policy, defense policy, national security policy are not areas where Governor Romney has a lot of experience. Presumably then, you might conclude that he would lean more heavily on advisors to help shape his views in these areas. What can you tell us about his team of advisors? Is it Bob Zoellick and the internationalists, or is it John Bolton and the neocons, or who is it?
It's a good question. And of course, I'm guessing, like we all are. One thing that I think it's worth remembering is that when George W. Bush won in 2000, and then when he appointed his cabinet in 2001, he had sort of both of those camps represented. And before the 9/11 attacks, it wasn't that easy to tell which one was stronger, right? Because he had Colin Powell, and he had Condi Rice. Condi had been his aide de camp and, you know, his woman Friday throughout the campaign, really helping him day by day with the campaign and with foreign policy. Powell was the great American hero of his generation at that time, and obviously still a great American, but at that point his reputation was sky high, and you would certainly have not thought that some recycled Secretary of Defense from the Ford administration would wind up being more powerful than Powell. And so it's pretty hard to tell now, because we haven't even gotten to the cabinet yet. Even when Bush did have his cabinet, we still couldn't tell who was going to be the most influential until about maybe a year later. But OK, so I guess what I basically said is your question's impossibly hard. But if I had to venture my opinion, from what I see, most of the top foreign policy advisors to Romney that I know are pretty darn smart and reasonable, moderate people. I'm not saying Bolton's not smart, but he's pretty conservative. And you know, obviously, I think you couched it as, you know, he would be on more of an extreme, and I would agree. My sense is that it's people like Mitchell Reese, Rich Williamson, Kofor Black, who have been very influential with him, Bob Zelik now. On the other hand, his day-by-day companion is Dan Senor. Dan's a friend of mine and a smart guy, but he's associated with the early days of the Iraq invasion. Now, his job, you know, he was the spokesman for George Bush during the early days of the Iraq invasion. And as spokesman, you aren't really allowed to venture your own opinion. And that was a fairly extreme moment in Bush administration policy. So I'm not going to necessarily say that Dan's an extremist just because he was the spokesman for trying to make us all believe the Iraq invasion was working when it really wasn't. You know, he's saddled with that. But I'm not sure it's a complete indictment of his ability to be pragmatic. So the bottom line is, I would lean towards thinking that Romney's going to be pretty pragmatic. But you still made a very important, another important point at the beginning when you said he hasn't done this before, and he's going to have to make some huge decisions in that first year. And frankly, I think Obama's foreign policy has been pretty solid, but his first year decisions were not incredibly hard. He could sort of ease into the job. Yes, he had to add forces for Afghanistan, but everybody was calling for it by then, and the Iraq surge was over. So Obama took his time, as he should have, but it wasn't that hard. Yes, he allowed the generals in Iraq to keep forces a little longer than he had promised on the campaign trail, but you know, he was still able to say we ended the war within the first couple years or first 3 years of his administration, so it wasn't that hard. He didn't have to decide on the bin Laden raid that first year. He got time to learn on the job. Romney's going to have to decide in a first year, if he wins, if we go into Syria and if we strike Iran. Those are more sort of yes or no big decisions. Obama's decisions were more gradual and incremental, and therefore slightly easier, I would say. And I guess I would also say, one last point, in Obama's first year, to the extent he did make some mistakes, for example, hoping to have a detente with Iran, and then sort of overlooking some of the election problems in the June 12, 2009 Iranian elections. You know, he did make some big mistakes, but luckily for him, or because he's a bright guy, he figured out how to change policy quickly. And with Iran, he then pivoted to a very more, a much more muscular approach. But Romney, if his decision is going to be to start a war, you don't get to take that decision back. And so, I think the stakes are going to be pretty high. And does that make you want to stick with the guy who's got 4 years of experience over the relative newbie? I don't know. I don't know how to judge that one. But it is true that Romney may not have much time to learn on the job.
I'm Jim Bexfield, and I'm retired. And let me ask you sort of an impossible question almost. Suppose you tried to put yourself in the shoes of the Iranian leadership. How do you think they view the two candidates?
It's a good question. I'm going to begin by replaying how I thought about 2008, because I asked myself that same question when it was McCain against Obama. And there was a part of my thinking that thought the Iranians would prefer McCain, because they knew how to deal with what could be couched as the third term of George W. Bush. You know, they were not, maybe they were initially worried by George W. Bush, but by the end, they were sort of, you know, they had gotten the better of us for many years in Iraq. Yes, we turned the tables a bit in the last couple of years of the Bush administration. But they sort of knew how to play the game of having an American that they could portray as the great aggressor and the great Satan. Then Obama comes in, and he reaches out his hand to them, and they slap it back. And so Obama mobilizes this international sanctions effort, which I think has been pretty impressive. Now, maybe there's a slightly lower chance in the Iranian leadership's mind that Obama would use military force against them. On the other hand, they did see him triple forces in Afghanistan and kill bin Laden and kill Alaki and a few other things. But even if they think his likelihood of attacking them is lower than Romney's, do they really prefer an indefinite prolongation of sanctions where the American president has established an international consensus to keep them going? Whereas maybe Romney, you know, abruptly changes policy and drops a few bombs, or maybe he's seen as more closely affiliated with Israel, which he would be, and that makes it easier for Iran to go back to their old shenanigans. So I think if I were an Iranian, I could make the argument either way. If I really were a hardliner who was willing to accept the possibility of a strike on my nuclear facilities, I think I'd prefer Romney, because I feel like I know how to compete with that American. And the worst case is I get bombed. Big deal. I just build a new enrichment site further away, further underground and never let inspectors in. My bond program is set back 3 or 4 years, but I eventually get one, and no one's going to stop me. And that's, if that's my worst case, and I'm a hardliner who doesn't really care about the effect of that attack, then I probably prefer that world to a world in which sanctions cut my country's oil exports by 2/3 to 3/4 and jeopardize the political sustainability of the regime that empowers me to do all my nasty things around the world. So I think there's a case to be made that Iran should have more to fear from Obama. But again, I've also argued earlier that their differences are very minor. So that's why, in some ways, I went back to 2008. There was a little bit more of a clear difference among the two candidates back then. And I think Iran might have been more afraid of Obama than of McCain. So that's the best I can do. It's again, a speculation, but it's an interesting question.
More questions?
Thank you. Hi, I'm Chris Ritchie, and I'm here as an Army Reserve officer interested in defense policy. I attended a seminar with a DoD knowledgeable speaker who spoke on the rebalancing of forces to the Asian Pacific Rim, where the majority of people might think that means moving forces, or the majority of forces, to that area. The speaker, in their opinion, said that it would probably remain as single digits because of where all the forces are supposed to be allocated in the future. And I was just wanting to get your thoughts on that.
Thank you. I'm glad you brought that up, because even though I said I wasn't going to talk a lot about where the candidates seem to agree, this is an important change in policy under Obama. And I think it is worth spelling out a couple of things here. I think the speaker that you referred to is correct, or at least I would agree, that if you look at all the rhetoric about rebalancing, the military changes associated with it are quite modest for the magnitude of the rhetorical effect we tried to generate. And of course, the military redeployments or repositionings are only one component of rebalancing, and other parts of it are supposed to be greater attention from top American officials. And I think the Obama administration has done a good job with its speeches, with its trips by Panetta, and before him Gates and Clinton and the president himself, to the region. They've managed to work together well with our allies and convey a sense of unity, and gotten in China's face sort of just the right amount. Not overly provocative, but enough in the aftermath of China being a little bit of a bully in regard to these disputed seaways and islands in the South and East China Sea. And of course, also China's unwillingness to condemn North Korea for the sinking of the Chonan. And only, you know, after a little bit of opposition did it go along with sanctions after the 2009 North Korean nuclear test. So China set itself up for a little bit of a pushback. And in some ways, what's impressive is how much of an effect we've created psychologically with a very minimal repositioning of forces. Because as you know, what are the repositionings? Well, we're not really changing anything in Korea. I mean, we're trying to move south in Korea with the forces to get them out of Seoul, but we're not changing the numbers. And the numbers are actually less than they were 10 years ago. And we're not going to put that second brigade back in South Korea the way it used to be there. In Japan, we're actually trying to move 7,000 Marines off Japan to Guam. And that's an interesting subject in and of itself. And I'm not a big supporter of that because of the price tag. I think we could actually bring the 7,000 Marines back to California and add more prepositioned equipment on ships in the region for a lower cost and greater strategic flexibility. But that would sort of get in the way of the whole rebalancing, because then it would look like we're pulling back, and I can see why officials don't want to do it. But still, no one's talking about adding forces in Japan. There's no talk of putting a second carrier in Yokosuka or anything like that. There's not even talk of putting a carrier homeported in Hawaii, for that matter. We're going to send 2,000 Marines to Guam eventually for occasional rotations. To Australia. And that sounds pretty good, except 2,000 Marines. I mean, I love Marines. We all love Marines, and they're tough guys. But 2,000 Marines in a part of the world where the typical major powers army numbers somewhere between 250,000 and 500,000. and also where Australia's distance from the key contentious areas of East Asia is sort of similar to Costa Rica's distance from New York. And we don't base, you know, forces in Costa Rica or Panama to protect Boston. And that's sort of like what you'd be doing with these Marines. I mean, they're a long ways away from any place they'd need to fight. And so what's interesting about the rebalancing is how much we've gotten out of a fairly modest set of changes. And I applaud the Obama administration because it signifies, all these changes do signify, one last thing. Panetta said, of course, at the Shangri-La dialogue that now 60% of the Navy will be based in the Pacific. Except, as you all know, Navy forces based in the Pacific can also cover the Persian Gulf because we often send carriers to the Gulf from the Pacific, which means there's no inevitability about any change here at all. You have to assume there's going to be a little greater focus on the Pacific, or Panetta wouldn't have bothered to say that, but it doesn't deprive us of tactical flexibility. Going from San Diego to the Persian Gulf is arguably just as convenient as going from Norfolk to the Persian Gulf, especially when Egypt is in turmoil and you're not 100% sure about the Suez Canal. So my bottom line is they've done beautifully with very small policy changes. And I think it was just right. It's what the doctor ordered, because we actually did not want to get any more provocatively in China's face than we needed to send the message that we wanted to send. And we also didn't want to have to spend any more money than we needed to. So I would agree with the speaker that you heard that the changes are relatively modest. And I think you mentioned in the single digits, single digit thousands. That's the sum total of the reallocations, as I can tell, best I can tell.
Please join me in thanking Michael O'Hanlon for a very informative talk. Thank you.